subject is intimacy with God. Very dear to my heart. Because I'm a worshipper. First I'm a worshipper and then I come stand here to speak God's word. And every worshipper must understand this. That intimacy with God. You cannot complete worship without being intimate with God. You cannot fulfill that calling of being a worshipper until and unless we don't mingle with Him. Now what is the meaning of intimacy? It means closeness. It's being understanding the relationship. It's being near to the Lord. Being familiar to the Lord. Knowing His heart, listening to His heartbeat, and He listening to yours. That's intimacy. Why were we created? Colossians 1:16. For by Him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers, or rulers or authorities, all things were created by Him and for Him. So you and I, we both were created, we all were created for God. Amen. So that we can worship Him. God created us in His pleasure so that we, as His creation, would have the pleasure of knowing Him. Worship is pleasing the Lord. And prayer is like an aroma which goes into His nostrils. So there is a difference between praise and worship. And so worship is something which is very close and very intimate to the Lord. God gave man a mind so that he can know God. We can know God. God gave man a heart so that we could love God. And God gave man a will so that we can obey God. He gave us a free will. He never forces His will on our lives. He asks us to choose, and it's up to us. In between the crossroads, what we choose. And He always put that place of crossroads in our lives. At least in my life, I have been to those places where I have to choose. And praise God, every time I chose Him, there are options. And we have to choose right. When I was a girl, I was a young girl, and I used to have lots of friends. Even today, I have them as my friends. And being with two friends at a teenage, it's like you want to be always with them, day and night. Night wouldn't be possible because we don't stay in the same house. But we would like to be with those friends because you share those little secrets. You have certain things to talk about, but you don't share it with your parents. It's between the two friends. They joke around. Buddha is laughing. I know this. You know, at that age, you feel like being with your friends all the time. Wherever they go, even though we don't want to go there, we go just to be in the companionship. That is how God is. That is what God did in the times when Adam was in the Garden of Eden. God would come and meet with him in the cool of the day. And he would come and have fellowship with him. So that there was a koinonia, there was a togetherness of, and that same thing which Adam lost, God expects it even today. Praise God that the veil is open and we can go and enter into that presence of God. And this is a deliberate step from your end and my end. The pursuit of intimacy is an intentional commitment to take steps towards God. We have to run and chase. I intentionally commit myself to take steps to meet with God. I made a deliberate effort. Going to church is a deliberate effort. It's meeting my God. And how do we attain this companionship? The answer is James 4:8. Draw near to God and He will draw near to you. Now, it's very clear. Draw near to God. That means first step is my step. Then He will come near to you. In other words, John 15:4. Abide in me and He will abide in you. Again, me who takes the first step and then comes to God. So I will abide first and He will abide in me. He has already taken the bigger step of bringing us closer. Now it's my turn to take the next step. The first step first step. Now God met with people in different manner. He meets with you and me in different ways. With some people He can meet through visions. With some people He can meet in prayer. Some people He can meet during worship. And this has been in the past, if we read the Bible, that He met with each person differently. God may meet with you and me in different manners, and all may not experience the same way. God met with Moses face to face. God met with John in a vision. God met with Abraham as Melchizedek. So He met with them in a different manner. Now I have one place where God met Abraham. He visited him. There were three people. The Bible records that there were three men who walked into his home. And Abraham insisted that they should eat with him. And he was hurried, and he was a great man of hospitality. And he gave in to those three people. Now it's very interesting to see that God Himself visited a mere man just to bless him. That was the promise that He made God, made to Abraham direct. And He said that you will have a child. Now, it is very interesting that during that period, at that phase, God was about to do something in Sodom and Gomorrah. And there He Himself did not go, because there only two men went. But with Abraham there were three men. That means God makes sure that He visits His dear ones. He need not go to the place of Sodom and Gomorrah for destruction. His angels are enough. And that's the thing which I want you to have in your minds, that God is there to meet with you, to bless you, to give you a future. And at that point, God is talking to Abraham. There is something very divine which is happening. God is going to tell him this plan about Sodom and Gomorrah. When there are two friends, there is no secret between them. It's not binary. It can never happen binary. I am the only person sharing the secret and the other person doesn't tell. That is not friendship. At least for me it doesn't happen. Because it's always two-way. She will also tell me all what she has been through. And I will also tell her all what I have been through. It's not binary. We sometimes, I come to that point that I am compelled, I just can't wait. I want to share something which has been blessed me, or something, even my deepest of secrets, I want to share it with my friend and want to tell her that this is what has happened. And that compelling comes in because you are so intimate with one another, you trust that person fully, that I will tell her, she won't tell it to anyone. And that is what God does. God here is compelled to tell Abraham the secret. So can you imagine, God understands friendship so well? That He trusts Abraham with His secret. And He is telling Abraham about what He is going to do with Sodom and Gomorrah. Now today, we are going to learn on the pattern. There is a pattern to enter into the presence of the Lord. It doesn't happen just you feel like going in and you are there. It doesn't happen that way. There is a process, there are stages, and these stages are very clearly depicted in the tabernacle of Moses. We are going to go there. The tabernacle reveals the pattern or the order to meet with God. God did not give the tabernacle just like that because He was interested in, just to bring people like that. No. It was basically, it was only the high priest Aaron who was going inside. Rest all people. But yet He gave everything on the word on how it was supposed to be. And everything was mentioned so much in detail that it reveals every aspect of the tabernacle reveals Jesus Christ. And just I'm going to take a glimpse of it. In itself, it's a big study. Tabernacle is a fantastic study to be done. So today we study the little bit of tabernacle and how we approach God. And this is fantastic for all the worship leaders. Because, or for the congregation, it's fantastic for people to understand how we enter into prayer. There's a mode. There is a process, there is a pattern, there is an order, and this is what if we follow, we are going to make it. Amen. So this is what I am going to put it, because we are now into the And I confirmed with pastor because 2 weeks back I was asking God, because I'm not a prayer warrior, be very honest. I don't sit diligently praying, but I'm consistently in communion. But giving a special time is very difficult for me. At least I was not doing it in my physical level. I was not doing it. And this year God impressed on me that this year I'm going to be an intercessor. And I've decided on that. And he said, this is where you're weak at, yeah? So you get yourself right. And this year I've already started and begun. And that's why this subject was laid in my heart, that I should be an intercessor for the Lord. I have to come closer to God. Yes, worship. I'm a worshiper. 90% of my prayer is worship. I hardly ask for myself. God has been blessing all the time, consistently, even without me asking. But I need to intercede for His people, for the church. And this is where God has brought me in this year. So we're going to study on the pattern. Now, what is a tabernacle? Tabernacle means dwelling place. It's a residence. Tabernacle symbolizes the pattern in three stages. There are three courts. The outer court. Now I have just a design or a layout. You see the outer court, where you have two things, two furnishings. One is the laver, which has the water, and the other one is the altar of sacrifice. Now, this outer court, you see the area? Area is biggest, which is the outer court. Then the holy place is a little medium size, and the holy of holies is the smallest. Now, this is the reality. Yes. The reality is very few make it till the end.
Yes.
That's why the area is also very small. And we are not going to wait here.
Amen.
I want you to go inside.
Amen.
With me. So outer court you have the bronze laver, which is actually to wash, cleansing. And you have the altar of sacrifice where the priest would make the sacrifices. Now, first thing is the gate. The word of God says, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving and then into the courts with
praise.
So praise is happening inside the outer court, but at the gates we are accepting Jesus as our Savior. Until and unless we don't accept Jesus as our Savior, we cannot enter it. So first thing is thanking the Lord for all what he has done. Second is repentance. Here these two depicts altar of sacrifice. Sacrificing oneself, sacrificing our fleshly desires. We understand that all what God has done. Here this place is about repentance. This place is about, you're very close to the outside world. This place is a place of distraction as well. Then comes the holy place, where you have the showbread, the lampstand, and the altar of incense. And the last one, the most holy place, that there you have the Ark of the Covenant, where God would come and meet with his people. Now, we compare these three with the stages of intimacy. Matthew 7:7, ask and it shall be given you, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you, for everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Now see, these three realms, we have that scene. These three realms is first, outer court is for asking. Here you ask. In the holy place, you seek. And in the most holy place, you knock. And these are insights which I'm going to give you. Those are revelations and those are very beautiful. John 14:6, Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So here again, outer court, way, very holy place, the truth, and life is in the holy of holies. Yeah? And what the So I will enter his gates with thanksgiving, accepting Jesus, and into his courts with praise. So here, initially, when I choose songs for worship, I ensure that I follow this. The glory of God, the presence of God just doesn't come like that. I'm very mindful of the limits of what I choose. I don't say thank you, Jesus, at the end. It's at the beginning, I have to thank the Lord. So we have to be considerate about how God has given the pattern and we choose that. Asking place, the way. First thing God deals here is with the obstacles between us and Him. God looks for repentance. Heart is ready to surrender. Actually, He is making a place for Him to reside. He is preparing you and me, and He is making a throne so that He can sit on it. So this place is about washing. We are getting cleaner and better for Him to reside and sit. God is preparing us so that we can be worthy that He can sit. So, as I told you, bronze laver is for washing and the altar is for sacrifice. And God builds His throne. God prepares His dwelling place for Himself. He sets up His residence. In this place, the flesh rules. Here, the flesh is ruling. Place where the flesh speaks, we talk. This is a place of distraction, place of repetition. Here the I factor is dominant. I, me, myself, mine, all this is dominant. You talk about our needs. You talk about God, you forgive me. This is a place of repentance. Here we can see that we are prone to the world and there is no intimate fellowship here. Because you are outside. Here I give my burdens and my troubles at this space after court. We talk and He listens. Here we are talking. Here we are unloading our burdens. Cast your burden unto Jesus. It's here. Here we learn how to trust Jesus. That He can bring us out of prison. Unless and until I don't loosen my burden, I cannot enter stage 2. So here we give all to Him. We all lay down our burdens at the outer face, outer court. Then we enter, once we are done with that, we enter into the holy place. This is the seeking place. You see the furnishing, the lampstand, the word of God. It sets you free. Yes? It signifies the light of the Lord. That He is the light unto my heart. John 8:12. Again, therefore, Jesus spoke to them and saying, I am the light of the world. It signifies the lampstand. And he who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have light of life. So here is the place of me getting enlightened by the Lord. This is the seeking place. We are seeking the word of God. We are searching the treasures. We are trying to study the Bible. We are trying to meditate. And this place is a place where you do that. Showbread signifies the bread of life. John 6:51. I am the living bread that came down out of the heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread also which I gave for the life of the world is my flesh. And also this incense again represents Jesus who is interceding for you and me. It's His prayer which are going. So we pass the stage of asking for ourselves. There is no giving of needs here. Here we are getting enlightened. This is a place of seeking God's fellowship. Here the place of praise begins. Because it's the middle court. So sweet words of praise close our mouth. Words like precious Jesus, wonderful God, comes out of our mouth. Here we are still talking. Here the bondages are broken. Here is a place of liberty because the truth, the word, sets us free. This place is a place of waiting. And this many people give up. This place is a place of tasting. I remember when my elder daughter, she was around 2 years old, she would refuse to eat because she's not in a mood to eat or she's not having that appetite. What my maid used to do, she used to just put one small fish piece, fried fish in her mouth. She would run wherever she would go. And that is what God has done. He just gives you the taste. And sometimes people taste and they think that they are all done with their meal. It's not like that. We still have to consume Him with the holy place. And that's why we eat fully. It's like only smelling the biryani and you think that you are eating. So this is not, or just taking one morsel of biryani and you think you are full. It's not like that. In the spiritual realm, there is much more. Here there is waiting. Isaiah 40:31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Now these things shall mark them. These things are all happening here at this stage. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. They shall renew their strength. Physically, you are already exhausted at the outer court because you are giving all the time, crying and repenting. And physically, you are exhausted. In the middle court, God is actually starting to take over. And you are renewing your strength, your spiritual strength, as well as the physical strength. Yes. There is quickening happening here. But for them that wait upon the Lord, God gives strength so that we can go into the last realm, that is the knocking realm. Psalms 42:1-2. As the hart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? So you heard the thirsting is taking place. Now David is comparing himself to the male here. It's a heart. And I try to study why he is comparing heart. Heart is usually in the desert places. And there is always a shortage of water. And due to the heat, the best place for the heart is to reach out to the streams of water. There he quenches his thirst. The other thing which the heart does is to rescue or to run away from the dogs and the snakes. Because they smell the heart and they can eat the predators, they smell the heart. So inside the water when the heart is immersed, they cannot smell it anymore. So he finds refuge in that place where there is water. So this is why David is comparing that as the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you. I find my refuge in that stream of water. Amen. I find my refuge and my, you are my fortress. This is what he is trying to say, that I hide in you. Amen. The predators can no more see you. I find my safety in the water pools. I get refreshed here. So that's why we compare. When we can compare these three things, it's like the desert resembles like a difficult situation in our life. And what we do? We run after the Lord. The serpent, it depicts the devil is after us. We run again to the presence of God. The dogs are like difficult people who are around you. Again, we run into the presence of God. Now this is what David was all the time around. Difficult situations, difficult people, Satan always on the back. And he used to find his place of refuge at the water brooks. When his thirst was quenched and he was refreshed and he would find safety. When shall I come and appear before God? I am seeking you, Lord, I am longing for you, God. And suddenly the Lord quickens. Quickening means he's taking you in a few minutes into the holy place. But you have to wait. All we do is wait for the Lord to quicken here. And very difficult for us human beings to wait consistently till God is making us ready to quicken. So we don't know when it will happen. So we have to be there all the time. A divine energy. Here when the quickening is happening, a divine energy pours into you. Words become very few. Praise comes out. Here he tastes God's presence. Hunger is intensified and tears start to flow. Psalms 41:2. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon the rocks and established my ways. Stage 2 is not the place of intimacy yet. This stage is a stage where we ought to stay for a long time. We cannot move to the next stage in just a fraction of seconds. There is waiting. There is longing for the Lord. Then you move, once the Lord begins, you move into the third realm. That is the Holy of Holies. This is the knocking place. Life. The way, the truth, the life. And this place where you have the ark of the covenant, the mercy seat, where God meets with man. This is a meeting place. Here, this is a knocking realm. Why do I say that? I remember when I saw a vision, and it was a vision which I didn't understand then. After a few weeks I understood. I was in a place where there were a lot of doors, many doors, and I was knocking, one door would open, I would enter it. Then again many doors, I had to choose which door I would go. Again I would knock, again I would enter. Then again doors, only doors, doors, doors. And I didn't understand it. But what God told me after a few months, that Priya, those are all secrets. I'm revealing to you. You knock every door, I'll open it for you. Okay. And I'll show you the secret, and you'll enter into that secret.
Okay, yeah.
Every time you knock the door, I'll open it for you, and you'll enter into that secret. Okay. This place is a place where you get those secrets from the Lord. Okay. It's a knocking realm. Place of union. Place of intimacy, true communion. Here the bee calls out to me, heart to heart, silent place, secret place. There is mingling of life, place of glory of God. Spirit meets the Creator. Our spirit meets the Creator. Silence prevails. Presence of God becomes clear. Flowing communion, unceasing communion. We are immersed in God's presence. Our own words, which come out of our mouth, amazes us. Words of love, words of intimacy. Your communion starts to begin. No obstacles in this area. Place of abundant light. Place of abundant peace. Place of quiet rest. Place of spiritual wealth and riches. Place of God's love. God's love. Here God is all alone. He is the prominent one. Silence takes over. Words become offensive here. We let go of distractions. You're changed. There is a peace which enters in. This place Satan doesn't know. Job 28:7-8. There is a path which no power knows, and which the vulture's eye hath not seen, the lion's whelp have not trodden it, nor the fierce lion passed by it. So it's a good news that the Satan doesn't know this place. Only you and me can enter through Jesus. In this place, our needs finish. They're not important at all. We sing that song. When all things that surround become shadows in the light of and I worship you, don't you worship? What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For whose sake I have lost all things, I consider them rubbish that I may gain Christ. In this realm, Philippians 3:8, Paul is writing that I consider all things rubbish. This is what is more important for me. Here let us totally surrender. Now, when an eagle flies, initially from the earth it picks up. It flies, it flaps. It takes an elevation, it goes higher, it flaps. It's using its energy. and suddenly it goes higher and higher. What is actually a soaring eagle? Soaring eagle is a gliding eagle. It doesn't flap all the time. It flaps only initially. The more it goes higher and higher and higher, there it doesn't need to flap. You know why? The air currents help it to glide in that higher places. The air currents which are flowing, every air current which comes in, the eagle, if for example air current is coming, the eagle will take over. Again another air current comes, the eagle will take over. What is that air current? It's the spirit of the Lord. It helps you and me to glide in the spirit. We no more clap with our energy. All that clapping we do in the good places, the outer court and the holy place. But inside, if God takes over, He takes control. You are nobody. You are just a vessel which God uses to commune. Yes. The spirit which is in us communes with the Creator. Psalms 42:7. Deep calls unto thee, and the noise of the waters comes. All the waves and the billows are gone over me. I am going to slide for you to show what is a water spout. Water spout is like a funnel-shaped tornado, sometimes hundreds of feet wide, extending from the surface of the sea or a lake to the cloud base and caused by the violent circulation of air. Now this would exactly happen when the high priest would keep the altar of incense on the Ark of the Covenant and the smoke would come out and would go out of the tent, out of that tabernacle, and there would be a big cloud on top. You read the Bible, you know what I'm saying. It would be same. God would be like this. Same. But instead of water, surface would be the mercy seat. And then God would come and meet with his people. Here, the cloud of glory would rest upon the top. It's like a funnel shape. And top would be the Lord Almighty, who's meeting with the people. You're thy waves and thy billows are gone over me. That means I no more can swim, Lord. I've gone to thee. And there my energy is zero. Because the waves are so strong that we just have to stay still. Because if we try to do something, we're going to break. And this place is a place to let go of ourselves. And God takes over. I have to surrender myself. Now there are two intercessors here. Jesus himself and the Holy Spirit which is in you. I become the vessel for this intercession. I become the medium of worship unto God. Groaning without uttering. No words here. There is a spirit. Have you come to that? I think I have come to that place where I don't talk. I just still tears are flowing and there is a communication.
Yes.
And those communications are so strong. Sometimes I feel I get consumed. Yes. I'm scared. I cannot take it. I tell God, God, I can't go further. I can't go further. Because it's difficult for me to stay this way. My physical flesh doesn't allow me to. I get scared because that glory is so high. And that happens when you're one-to-one with the Lord. That intimacy of God. There were times when I would see physically, I'm sleeping, but my mind is actually talking. And I thought I didn't sleep on the whole night. I'm awake and I'm actually whole night. The Spirit of the Lord in me is communicating with the Holy Spirit. And there are so many things which we have taught throughout the night. Unfortunately, certain things I remember and most of the things I forget. But there is a talk. There is a communication between the two spirits, in me and the Holy Spirit. And in this place, you have two intercessors. You become the medium. Jesus is interceding so that you are allowed in the holy place. And Holy Spirit is interceding through you. You understand the difference? Jesus is interceding so that you are eligible in that place. And Holy Spirit speaking in tongues is useless. You are not actually speaking. It's only spirit with me, spirit. You are not talking. So speaking in tongues doesn't happen in that way. Because this is not praying with the spirit, it is praying in the spirit. There is a difference. You are not praying with the spirit, you are praying in the spirit. Praying with the spirit is done in the holy place, where we wage a war against the strongholds of the enemy, and it's a language. Here prayer becomes presence of God, and presence of God becomes prayer. Amen. Human spirit meets the Creator. Prayer without ceasing takes place. Total immersion. We just can't stop praying in this land. God does not want us to depart from this place. Now here, God takes over. In the beginning, it's I, me, myself. You're God, 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 God. You don't actually exist, only you are the vessel which God is using. He stays with you. Receiving breath. In the Holy of Holies, only the power of love is evident. All over you can see God and His love. God is walking with you. The door opens, we knock, and another door proceeds to open. And He's all over you. He takes His way. Your spiritual desires are met here. This is actually the receiving realm. You may have asked for yourself in the beginning. Ask, seek, knock. But here actually you are receiving the spiritual attainments, spiritual achievements. You see, Catherine Newman, when she used to have her meetings, there would be a time where everyone is at this realm. And people are just crying. No words. They're just crying and weeping. And suddenly she would say, calm down. Now, already they're quiet. You don't need to calm down. But what she means is, consider that silence. Because here, she would tell you and me that just be spiritually calm in this place. And what she would tell, now you ask. Because this place is asking what God wants you to ask. It's about spiritual agreement. It's not about give me a job or give me a husband. It's not that what you ask. Here you ask destiny for nations. Here you ask for souls. Here you ask for greater visions, what God wants to do. And there she would say, be spiritually calm and now you ask. Now is the time and God will grant you. Because this asking is different. This asking is the will of God. Asking is not the one which is in the outer world, but it is in the fulfilling of the spiritual attainments. This is a place of hiding. When God says, I am the hiding place, actually He Himself is the hiding place. Now, as I told you with Abraham, God revealed His secret. He was at that realm, in that spiritual realm, where God is compared. Genesis 18:17. Then the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do? God does not want to hide secrets from His intimate. And here Abraham starts to intercede for the nation of Sodom and Gomorrah. Yes. This is exactly what happened there. He is pleading to God, the just God, to be merciful for Sodom and Gomorrah. Probably Lord was in his mind and or maybe the whole nation was in his mind. But here he is asking for the whole nation of Sodom. God, please, there were 40 or there were 35. He's like trying to negotiate bargaining with God. Will you be like this? Will you still? And the way he's asking is so gentle. Amazing. Now, there were people who walk in this realm. When others see, they can see the glory of God on their faces. Like Moses, he carried God's glory along with him. Moses, in himself, he felt it normal. He didn't know that he was having that radiance on his face. The people saw and they were frightened that he is carrying that radiance on his face. Exodus 34:29-30. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with two tablets of the testimony in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant because he had spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant. and they were afraid to come near him. Exodus 34:33-35. When Moses finished speaking to them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever he entered the Lord's presence to speak with him, he removed the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanding, they saw that his face was radiant. Then Moses would put the veil back over his face until he went in to speak with the Lord. So this happens when you are face to face with God. You see, we know about it. This is not about Old Testament alone. When we read about Peter and the other apostles, when they walked, the shadow was healing many people. This is in the New Testament. And what actually was happening, they carried the presence. They were all the time that they asked for. They carried the presence of the Lord wherever they went, and the shadows would just heal. They wouldn't know also that people are getting healed. But that power, that energy, the God, the Holy Spirit, Lord, walking with them would just heal. That same thing would happen when Catherine Kuhlman would go to those. She would walk in the lobby, and the people working there would repent and cry. She wouldn't speak a word. She herself would all the time cry. She was a woman who would all the time weep. And when she would walk those passages, people would fall in conviction and they would cry. What actually was happening? She was in that realm where God was all over her. And that case would bring that presence of God, and that presence of God would convict people. And I want to be like that. When I walk, that shadow of mine should fall on people and there should be healing. Please, I want to be like that. So this doesn't come like that. It has to be a lot of sacrifices involved. And I want God to prepare me in that way that when I walk or when I pray over people, there should be healing. I need to carry that presence of God all the time. Amen. Consistently.
Yes.
You see, when the high priest, when he would enter into the most holy place, the way he would come back was not turning back and walking out. He would go backwards.
Yes.
He would walk backwards. He was supposed to walk backwards. He was not supposed to show his back. You know why? His focus should always be the presence of God. He should always see. He should always be face to face with God. He cannot dishonor God that way. And that is how we are called to be. All the time seeking God. All the time knocking into the secrets. All the time asking for nations. God desires this communion with us daily. Many believers are just in the first area. And they think they've done praising, jingling, noise. That's all output. They're called to be in the inner and most holy realm. By God's name is from, see, when the tabernacle was given to Moses, God told first to prepare the Ark of the Covenant. Then the other things furnished the lampstand came last. All the things followed. But first was the Ark of the Covenant. You know why? Because God works from the inside. That's how he works. When I was sharing on the podcast, he works inside, he works in the heart, he works in the spirit, he works in the deeper places. Then the outer things are beautiful. When we are intimate with God, we know God's mind, his ways. Fellowship with God is a daily experience. God says, follow me. God walks, but sometimes we are not walking. He will not stop for you. He consistently walk. And as a result, you miss. Now, for example, I have my baby or my daughter, and we are just walking, and I told her, you just hold my hand. But there would be a time when she gets distracted to the marketplace, or she would see the shop or the mall. She would leave me, but I'm walking. This is what happens. God, we have to all the time follow him. Jesus said, follow me. He didn't say, I'm going to wait for you, you'll come and then we'll all go. No. He said, follow me.
Yes.
If I'm intimate with God, God blesses me in all areas of my life.
Yes.
He is concerned more about my life than what I have to be concerned with. We may feel at times that God is responsible for the situation of which I am today, but the truth is that it's me who messed up. God is not the reason for my mess. It's somewhere I have missed. At times there may be trials and tests that God puts in, but He will strengthen you and me. It may be sometimes Satan's attack, but all we need to do is show Him that He is all in all. Our shield, our rock, our refuge, our strong tower, our hiding place. And this case, the hiding place, there's lot and lot. There's a cost involved. There's a price which you and me need to pay, and that price is your time.
Yes.
Your time with God, your intimate moments with God. And let us all try to pay that price to be in the Holy of Holies. Because this is the place where we all want to be in eternity, closest to the Lord. Currently, true currently is created, but we all, with unmade face, beholding as the mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as from the Lord. Matthew 5:6. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Now, who is hungry? Hunger is for believers. And those who are not believers, those who are not seeking the Lord, they are like the sick people who lose their appetite. We need to be hungry for the Lord.
Yes.
And today if you feel that you are not at that place, we will pray for you.
Yes.
The elders, the pastors are all here. It's a perfect time, the beginning of the year. We will not be the same. We want to enter in that sacred place. And I think we all desire to be here.
Yes.
That we can enter into the Holy of Holies.
Yes.
All those things, the worldly things, doesn't matter. How does it matter? What purse you carry or what shoes you are wearing, it doesn't matter at all at that place. Because that's the place of divine achievements.
Yes.
And you all need to see this place full.
Amen.
And this will happen only when you enter into the Holy of Holies. So let's all stand, arise, and we worship God in the way He has called us to worship.